Hey everybody, I'm Maggie and we're on another episode of SRH Access Facebook Live. Today we're at our North Campus and I'm here with our sports medicine physician, Dr. Jane Chung. Welcome.
Thank you, Maggie.
We're excited to have you. We are, like I said, we're at our North Campus today. And if you have a live question for Dr. Chung, please post it below and we will get to it. So today's all about stress fractures and let's get started. So nice and basic, what is a stress fracture?
So a stress fracture is often called a fatigue fracture and it's an overuse injury. So it's weakening of the bones and this is due to repetitive and excessive stress on the bone. So what happens is our body is constantly building new bone and breaking down old bone. And when the body is breaking down bone faster than it's able to build new bone, then you run into the issue of possibly having a stress fracture. And it can ultimately even lead to a crack in the bone. Stress fracture is important to know that's different than a traumatic fracture, such as from a fall or an injury.
So what causes these stress fractures, or what the most common causes of them?
So most common causes are those athletes who try to do too much, too fast, too soon. So think of your young athlete, they're going into freshman cross country, they're sitting around like a couch potato all summer long, and 2-3 weeks before the season starts, they're ramping up 15, 20 miles that they're logging in a week. And so too much, too soon, too fast, any abrupt and sudden changes in an athlete's training regimen, such as in their frequency, intensity, or duration, are often frequent causes of these types of injuries.
So at Scottish Rite Hospital, what is the process if a patient is to come in with a potential stress fracture? What are the tests that are done and how is it diagnosed?
So a stress fracture usually is diagnosed with x-rays or radiographs on exam. Sometimes they may need to have further imaging such as an MRI or a CT to further evaluate their injury. For treatment, every stress fracture is treated on an individual basis. So we look at several things. The athlete's age, what type of sport they play, the severity of the stress fracture, the location of the stress fractures, all of those come into play in how we manage and treat these kids. But it is important to know that stress fractures oftentimes can take weeks to months to heal and can be sometimes a season-ending injury for many of our athletes.
What are some of the, you're talking about these different treatments. We know it depends on the patient and mm-hmm. the age and all of that, and if they're still growing. So what are the different treatments that we offer for that?
So typically if it's a lower extremity stress fracture, which is the most common types of stress fractures, so we'll see either a stress fracture in the shin bones, either the tibia or the fibula. We can also see stress fractures in the foot and the metatarsal bones as well. But for lower extremity stress fractures, typically it may require a period of immobilization, whether the individual is placed in a boot or in a cast. Sometimes they may need to be non-weight bearing in crutches for a period of time. Treatment can further include physical therapy as the athlete progresses and their stress fracture is starting to heal. It can also encompass a nutrition consult by one of our registered nutritionists to see if there are other things that we can help the athlete get back into play.
Are there certain sports that you're seeing that are most common with these stress fractures?
Certainly stress fractures are very common in athletes who participate in endurance sports, such as your cross-country athletes, also those athletes who participate in repetitive high-impact activities, such as our high-level gymnasts, soccer players. Those are probably mm-hmm. some common sports that we see these injuries in.
Okay. So, and then kind of getting into the prevention of it. I know that especially sports medicine, we're really big on the prevention education. So mm-hmm. what can parents and athletes really know about how can we prevent this from happening?
Right. So it's important to know what caused the stress fracture.
Right.
In the first place, as there are many risk factors. A lot of times these kids aren't just getting adequate nutrition and enough calories. And so they are more prone to getting these types of injuries. Sometimes their vitamin D and calcium levels are very low, and so their bones are not very strong, leading them to be at increased risk to have these stress fractures. During the ages of 11 to 18 is the peak time when kids are building their bones and their bone mass to carry them into adulthood. And so it's crucial that they take enough vitamin D and calcium to build a basis and foundation for having strong, healthy bones.
Yeah. I know one of someone that posted a question yesterday, they were talking about kind of what is the percentage of reoccurrence of these stress fractures. So if someone comes in and, you know, they heal up and they're released to go back to sports, what are the chances that a stress fracture in the same area could happen again, or maybe like on another foot in the same area or something like that?
So once you fully recover and heal from a stress fracture, you shouldn't be more prone to keep having them. However, if you do, then you want to look at several factors. For instance, if it's their foot and their metatarsal bone that they keep fracturing, is it because the type of shoe wear that they are wearing? Do they not have enough arch support? Or maybe it's the type of foot that the athlete has. Are they very flat-footed and their ankles pronate? Or are they very high arched? And so looking at their anatomy of the foot, and do they need orthotics or things like that, might be something to consider. Another thing to consider is if they keep having these stress fractures, is it truly something that's nutritional? Do they need to have their nutrition evaluated? Are they not consuming enough calories for their body to keep up with the demands of a sport that they're doing? So there are many factors to kind of look at.
Right. You were talking about a nutritionist that they could come see and kind of have a consult with. What is it that, you know, parents could maybe know about if they came to meet with one of our nutritionists, and what could they really get out of that?
Mm-hmm. So every athlete is different, and depending on the intensity and their training regimen, the caloric needs of each individual is very different. So for instance, a non-athlete will be healthy and fine just taking in 2,000 calories a day, whereas another athlete who trains 15 hours a week, that is inadequate for them. And so energy availability is something that we stress on in sports medicine, and that's the amount of energy that the body has to carry out not only the normal needs of growth and development, but also to sustain for all the additional activities and stressors that they're putting on their body.
That's a great resource that I think we have here. And I know another component of what you're talking about, these stress fractures, is this female athlete triad, which mm-hmm. I know is very dense and has a lot of components to it. But I think just getting on the baseline of what it is and maybe just educating parents on maybe what to be looking for mm-hmm. with their female athletes.
Right. So the female athlete triad is a medical condition, and it includes three components. That's low energy availability, low bone mineral density, and any menstrual disturbances or dysfunction. And you don't necessarily have to have all three of them to be diagnosed with the female athlete triad, and it's thought that all of those components are interrelated. So the main point is low energy availability is kind of the focal point of what causes all the other two components. And so basically the athlete is not consuming enough calories, or they don't have enough energy to fuel their body. And so low energy availability then impairs bone health, both directly and indirectly. Directly by suppressing the hormones from our body that help promote bone formation, and indirectly by decreasing estrogen levels, which then leads to abnormal menses or irregular menstrual cycles, and it also decreases bone health. And many people don't know that estrogen is very important for building healthy and strong bones in young women.
That's good to know. And I think, you know, as they're growing and they're, you know, they're turning into a woman, it's a big thing to be aware of. You know, I think another thing is, you were talking about the nutrition that's really big with the female athletes, but is there a certain thing symptoms that maybe that are really apparent
right.
that these coaches or parents or even teammates could maybe help out mm-hmm. with make the warning signs?
Right. That's a great question. So any athlete with a history of recurrent stress fractures or just recurrent bone stress injury is a red flag. If they notice any of their teammates with extreme weight loss or extreme worry or concern about their weight, mm-hmm. That's something to look out for. Also, any kind of unusual or restrictive eating behavior is concerning as well. And if the athlete is just fatigued, their performance is not where it used to be, and there's really not a known cause, that's another thing to look out for. And also certainly any history of irregular or absent menses for a period of time mm-hmm. in a female who has already begun her menstrual cycle, that's certainly something to look out for. A lot of athletes think when they're in season in their sport and they stop having periods, it's a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
But however that is concerning and often a first sign telling us that they're not getting adequate caloric intake or energy to fuel their body.
So I know these stress fractures, you know, it connects with this female athlete triad, and I think stress fractures as a whole is both female and males, but are you seeing it more in females with stress fractures, or is it just kind of across the board, young athletes, you're seeing more of them?
A lot of research has shown us that females are more likely than males to have stress fractures. However, the female athlete triad pertains only to females,
right.
But we know that something similar is going on in males. We are just not seeing as much,
mm-hmm.
And of course the hormones and such are different than
right.
in males, but a lot of athletes who are involved in weight-restricted sports or sports that emphasize a lean physique or aesthetics, such as your cross-country athletes, your dancers, your gymnasts,
mm-hmm.
those kids are at an increased risk for some of these things.
Cool. Well, I think we haven't gotten any live questions yet, so if you have any, please post them. But I think we're kind of wrapping up our session today. And one of the questions that came through yesterday was, what causes stress fractures in the metatarsals?
Interesting question. So there are different factors that can cause stress fractures in the metatarsals. One thing would be if the athlete is a runner, then to evaluate their running gait. It could be a biomechanical error. Their form may be incorrect, and so they're putting abnormal stress on certain parts of their foot that shouldn't have that type of abnormal stress or load. Another thing would be to evaluate their shoe wear. Is it appropriate for the type of foot that they have? Evaluating their training regimen, look at the arch of their foot, and also nutrition would be something to evaluate as well.
So there's just a lot of moving parts with this.
Exactly.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today. Great information on stress fractures. Tune in next week. We'll be back on SRH Access Facebook Live. Thank you.